have Secret Sister, Secret Sister Reveal this Tuesday night, 6:30 in the building. Please bring finger foods. Again, out of 10, make sure your gift is at the building, please. We have a men's business meeting today at 4:30. The minute should be on the board before the end of the week, hopefully. Nursing home service next Sunday at 2 o'clock. I encourage everybody to come and be part of that. Ladies' Day, January the 20th, which is a Saturday. The speaker will be Shelley Hazel from Valdosta. Cheryl Crummett, this is Jamie's sister, was taken to the ER with stomach pain, and she has to see a surgeon. We're in her prayers. Cheryl Ford, this is Ashley Nelson's mom. Her wrist surgery is coming Tuesday. She fell and broke her wrist a few weeks ago. So we need to remember to use our prayer for those events coming up. Hope that everybody will remember the prayers and take part in the activities that we are allotted. We met today at the men's meeting. The calendar was ratified last month. The budget was paid for it for this time. And so we're looking forward to 2018 being a productive year here at the congregation. And next Sunday morning, the budget and calendar will be presented to the congregation. We're going to get to that. We began the new year not being able to be present. Last week, I'd asked for parents to send me pictures of your children as you were measuring them, and I only got two pictures of somebody standing by the wall not being measured. So I don't know if you didn't get my email address or what, but you'll still send those. I still have the sermon here, and I'll just have to make a few changes, but I'd be glad to do that if you'll send me those pictures. We'll talk tonight about New Year's resolutions. We used to make those a lot. We think about the resolutions that are made, tradition down through the years, the New Year's resolutions are made. And most of the time, it's kind of a running joke as to how many weeks that resolution will last. Some last all year. People are successful. There are things that perhaps that you want to do and thought about doing. One of the things I'd like to encourage you to do is to read the Bible through this year. We have books out there for you. Some of them have been taken, a few left out there, to help you read through the Bible during the entire year. The book that's out there actually gives you some information to go along with it, so it's not just reading. There's some questions, and there are other books available and help plans, but let's do our best to read the Bible through this year. We think about resolving to be like someone. We think about how I'd like to be like some sports figure or some political person or something like that. Well, let's think about some Bible characters that I think we should resolve to be like in all aspects of our life. There's the Apostle Paul. Philippians chapter 3, 12 through 14. He said something here about forgetting the past and press toward the future. And we'll look at the verse in just a moment, but I'd like to make a few comments here. That's one of the things that hinders people sometimes from doing what they could do as a child of God, because they think about what they've done in the past. Paul had a lot of his past. He had a lot of bad, he had a lot of good. When he was preaching this sermon or presenting this lesson, the words that he used, he could have been thinking about the times, even when he was converted, and what he'd been doing to the Christians at that time. He could have thought about the good things he had done, about the times he had preached and all that. Notice what he says. He says, not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after that I may apprehend for that which I also am apprehended of Christ Jesus. He says, brethren, I count not myself to apprehend it, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth the things which are before, he said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. In this passage, as Paul's talking about his life and what he's doing, look at the great things he's saying here. Even if it was great things he had done, he said, I'm not thinking about those anymore, because some people fall into that trap of Satan also. They begin to say, well, look what I've done, and I've done so much already, why should I do anything else? But you see, that's not the way we need to look at this. We need to look at it from Paul's standpoint. He said, I don't think about those things. I don't think that I've already attained what I can attain. He said, I just keep pressing forward. And that's what we need in the Lord's church. We need to be resolved to be like the Apostle Paul as Christians, so that the congregation can progress, that we can progress as Christians, but that the congregation can progress as a congregation of God's people, and that lost souls can be added to the kingdom of God. If we all forgot about the things that had happened before, the good things and the bad, but look toward the future. And what can I do? Looking for those opportunities. There's opportunities on every corner. Paul said, let's forget the past and let's press toward the future. I'd like to see his resolve to do that this year. And then what about Joshua, who chose to serve God? I always love this passage, Joshua 24:15. You know, Joshua here, he'd been the leader of God's people for some time after taking over from Moses. I remember when he took over, and three or four times there, God said, be of good courage, and if you do these things, I'll be with you. And for the most part, in Joshua's life, of all the heroes of the Bible that we read about, he's one of the few that we do not read very much of any of things where he disobeyed God. We do read, as we talked about this morning, where his bad decision with the Gibeonites, not checking with God before he made that agreement. But other than that, there's not a whole lot about Joshua that you read that's bad. But notice what he says. He's talking to the people there, and again, he's coming to the end of his life. He said, if it seem evil to you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. He said, you make that choice. And notice the next part. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Gentlemen, I think all of us should take this to heart. As for as us and our household, we're going to serve the Lord. Doesn't matter what happens. Doesn't matter what other people do. Doesn't matter what people do, good or bad. We're going to serve the Lord. We're going to stand with God. Choose you this day. And it's a conscious choice that we have to make. Now, ladies, I understand you can draw an application there, but as Joshua was talking to the people there, I wanted to use the husbands and the men of the congregation as an example there, but all of us really need to make that choice. You know, it may be that we have family members who are not members of the body of Christ, and we wonder about them, but we turn to God's Word, we find out what God expects of us. You see, when we think about those who have gone on, I don't know what they knew or what they didn't know. I don't know what they did or didn't do, but I know what God expects of me. When I think back of the times when I've been able to teach people, that's one of the great questions that comes up. We have to understand, God's talking to us now. Here's what we know. Here's what we know we've got to do. God's a just God. God is a just God. And in judgment, he'll make the judgment that needs to be made. I don't have to worry about that. But he expects me to do what I know that he wants me to do. And so Joshua told the people on that time, you choose this day what you're going to do. We're going to serve, me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Wouldn't it be great to resolve that we're going to be like Joshua? We're going to serve the Lord no matter what. We're not going to put other things before God. We're not going to let anything get in our way. We're going to serve the Lord. Well, again, that's one of the things I hope we all resolve to do and be like Joshua, the man that served the God. What about this one? What about Abraham? Abraham was a great servant of God who commanded his children and his household. In fact, that's what this passage says. God said, for I know him. Can you imagine how great would it be to know and to have God say to you, I know him and I know what he's going to do and I know how he's going to direct his family. He said, I know him that he will command his children and his household after him. And they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment. God said, I know this man, Abraham. He said, I've been watching him for a while. And he had. All the times when he called him out of the land where his father dwelt, because there was idolatry there. And how he told him he would make of him a great nation, and through him all nations of the earth would be blessed. What a great thing this was for this man, Abraham. But you know, I think we need to resolve to be just like him. Because God knew this is a just man. This is a righteous man. And that's what we need to have in our lives today also. Well, let's move on. I'll resolve to be like Esther. Esther, who understood her responsibilities. Now, I don't want to go into the whole account there of Esther, but just briefly summarizing, you know how that Esther was a Jewess. Jew, when King Xerxes, thank you. When King Xerxes called for Vashti, his queen, to come and parade before the guest that he had, and some commentators believe that he was actually asking her to appear nude before all these people. Whether she were nude or scantily dressed, it didn't make any difference. She said, I'm not going for that bunch of drunks because they were intoxicated. And he says, no, I'm not. She said, I'm not going to do it. Well, he removed her from the throne. He had that power to do. So he chose a new queen, and of all the ladies he chose Esther, who happened to be a Jew. But you remember that there was a man in the kingdom who didn't like the Jews, and Haman didn't want the Jews. He'd been offended by Mordecai, and Mordecai happened to be Esther's uncle. Some commentaries think he might have been a cousin, but for the most part, they say he's an uncle. He had offended Haman, and Haman just wouldn't let go of it. So he determined he'd get rid of all the Jews. And you recall how he went to the king, and kings were bad about this, and somebody would go to them and pump up their pride and tell them what great kings they were, and then they'd ask something that they shouldn't be asking for. The Jews were going to be destroyed. And Mordecai found out about that. He sends Esther a message, and he said, you need to go to the king and talk to him about this. And he said, I like what Mordecai said there. He said, for we don't know for such time as this you've come into the kingdom. And that tells us the providence of God is seen throughout the book of Esther. In fact, that's one of the greatest books on providence that we can read. And here's Esther's answer to that. Go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan and fast you from me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and our maids will fast likewise, and so will I go into the king. Now remember, unless the king called her, even though she was queen, she could be killed just for going in the room where he was. She said, I'll go into the king, which is not according to the law. And she said, if I perish, I perish. What was Esther saying? She said, I see my responsibility. I understand. I've got a responsibility to go to the king and talk to him about this. If this doesn't happen, I may be killed. I may lose my life, but if that's what happened, that's what happens. She said, I'll go into the kingdom. You see, as followers of God today, there may be times, and there are times, when we have to make a decision if we're going to serve God or not. It may be that we're going to lose friends sometimes because of having to stand for God. You know, I talk with the young folks in the teen class on Sunday morning many times, and they talk about the things their friends do and how what they say and how they act and the things they do. And we talk about this. Sometimes you may lose a friend, but you've got to stand with God. And so far, and I appreciate our young folks because so far they say, they tell their friends, no, that's not right. That's not something we need to be doing. And I pray they always feel that way. And I hope we all pray for our young people, by the way. But Esther says, if I perish, I perish. Friends, that's the way we need to look at it. I don't care what happens, I'm standing for God, no matter what, even if I lose my life. It goes back to our teaching from Revelation, where the Christians are facing losing their life. Be thou faithful unto death, and I'll give thee a crown of life. Revelation 2:10. Well, let's move on to our lesson tonight before we get carried away on another rabbit. Let's resolve to be like Timothy. He was a student of the Bible. We've already talked about reading the Bible, but I mean studying the Bible. Simple verse, we looked at it many times. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You need to spend some time with God's word. Spend some time doing what we need to be about doing, what the verse says, is studying to make sure we're approved of God. We all can be better. There are no perfect individuals in the world. We can all change some things, make ourselves better here and there. We need to spend time with that word each day. You know, it's not that we don't have opportunity. Now, I know what happens a lot of times when we start talking about reading the Bible through in a year or in a month or whatever. And by the way, our friends with Eric Owen on Facebook, Eric's reading the New Testament through in 30 days. And he'll read it for you. You can listen to it on Facebook. You don't even have to read it. But first few days, it's really good. And then something happens. And you get behind it. And then something else happens, and you get a little, and before long, you're so far behind, you say, I can never catch up. Well, there's no need to try to get caught up. Just start where you are and go from there. Maybe your year lasts a little longer than everybody else's. Well, that's okay. God doesn't mind, as long as you're studying His Word. As you read through the Bible and you see the different things that happen, you know, I've asked the young folks also, you know, what do they like to study about? What do they like to read about? Well, they like to read about wars, and they like to read about different things like that, and they like to read about exciting things and people who stood up for God. Okay, that's all in God's Word. You know, I don't know if it's going to happen or not, but I understand it. Maybe thoughts of studying the Song of Solomon here at the congregation. Greatest love story ever written, Song of Solomon. A lot to it. Yeah, he's smiling at me because we've been talking about this for some time. But it's a book that's in the Bible that needs to be studied. You know, if we study the Bible, we can be better people. We can know from studying the Word we need to be Christians. We can know from studying God's Word how to be a better Christian. I always want to be the best husband that I can be. Haven't made that yet. I'm still working at it. I want to be the best father I can be, the best grandfather I can be, the best uncle I can be. God's Word tells me how to go about doing that. And so I want to be a student of that Word. So I want to resolve to be like Timothy, who was a student of the Bible. Well, what about Andrew? Andrew, who led us on to Jesus. Now here we're beginning the year. And I've asked you to do this before. I want to ask you to do it again. I know there's somebody in your life that you'd like to see obey the gospel. If you're a Christian, I'm 98% sure. I'll even go 99.9% sure. There's somebody you would like to obey the gospel. Well, why not start this year working towards leading that person to Christ? Be like Andrew. John chapter 1, beginning verse 40, one of the two which heard him speak, followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. And he first found his own brother Simon, and said to them, we found the Messiah, which is being interpreted to Christ. And he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas, which by interpretation is a stone. But what did Andrew do? First he found his brother, and he brought him to Jesus. See, that's the attitude we need to have. We need to resolve to be like him. There are souls that are lost, that are going to spend eternity in a devil's hell because of ignorance. Because of ignorance. They don't know what God wants them to do. They don't know how to go about it. Well, I just don't think I could. But yeah, you can. You can. There are different ways to do it. Well, I don't know how. Well, I can show you how. But you see, those lost souls, they need to know about Jesus. I noticed when they found the Messiah, they've been looking for the Messiah. The Jews have been looking for him for hundreds of years. He said, we found the Messiah. But when he heard about him, he first went to his brother and talked to him. Now, friends, we need to resolve to be like him and to go find a lost soul. That one we just thought about, and I know you did. You thought about somebody, and thinking about that person, let's think about how we can convert them. You need to be careful. I'll tell you a little bit of the fishers of men philosophy. It's kind of like a boy asking a girl to marry him. The first time you see that beautiful woman, you just don't run right up and say, will you marry me? She's going to say no. She's not interested. So you need to develop a little interest first. And then ask the question, would you like to see what the Bible says about that? Friends, we need to resolve to be like Andrew. He wanted his brother to be saved. Now these people we've been talking about are Bible characters that you can read about yourself in your study. We need to resolve to be like them. Here's one more. Here's Job. Job, who was patient in the circumstances of life. Patience is something, and we know it to be a virtue, but patience is something that we all need to work on. You know, we get so busy in life, and we get so caught up in how we're thinking and feeling and all this, that sometimes we forget about patience. But you think about old Job. So that Job arose, rent his mantle, shaved his head, and fell down upon the ground and worshiped. He said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I live and return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. think about all that happened to Job. All the calamities that fell him. He lost his children, lost his herds, his cattle, all those things. He lost all that. He's sitting there and he's got those boils all over him. And he's, you know, he's in a bad way. But in all this, Job sinned not or charged God foolishly. One of the saddest things I think I've ever heard is when a calamity happens in a family and some family begins to accuse God of causing all the things, all the problems. God didn't cause the problem. God's the answer to the problems, but he didn't cause the problems. Job understood that. Job had some questions. That's true. He did. But Job was a man of patience. He blessed the name of the Lord, and he didn't sin, and didn't charge God foolishly. Now, this coming year, 2018, there's no telling what we're going to face. I hope we all face good things, and that's all of us, all good things, nothing bad all year long. But most of us have been around long enough to know that every year has a little discouragement, every year has a little disappointment. When we face those things, let's think about Job. But we got to start now thinking, how am I going to be just like him? I'm going to go through those things. I'm going to trust in God. I'm going to believe in him and follow him. I'll get through those things. Job knew he would. On one occasion he said, I know that my Redeemer lives. Friends, your Redeemer lives too. We think about these characters. If we resolve to be like these, we can have a great 2018. We can have a great eternity. If you're here tonight, not a member of the body of Christ, why don't you resolve tonight to obey the gospel, become a child of God, put Christ on your baptism, be added to the family of God. Do not believe he's the Son of God. You need to study more about that? I'm glad to help you. I'm glad to show you the way. Through God's word, not Riley's words. Believe, repent of the things that are wrong, confess the name of Christ, immerse in water, have your sins washed away. God bless you. He wants you to go on to heaven. If you resolve to be like Christ, resolve to follow God this year, you can do it. Well, I don't think I can. I've got too many obstacles. You can. You've got brothers and sisters waiting to help you. Brother, you'll have brothers and sisters waiting to help you. Glad to help you. Why not obey the gospel tonight? If you're not living as you should as a child of God, why not come home? Even now, you stand there and say,
why do you make your brother?